Reading the scriptures, Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 to 21. Feel free to change the you to us. What's it say? That they, change the they to us, amen? That we. Are you ready? For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that we may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him glory in the church, by Christ Jesus, to all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh, how was that again? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. So Jesus is building his church, and he's the one that we're worshiping this morning. So let's stand in his presence and sing and rejoice in him. Hallelujah. And even this morning, the songs when I was preparing, it really is, we're declaring who he is, who Jesus is, and that which he's doing in the earth. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun.
The year of Jubilee.
Minister, release. Release into your spirit. Just keep your hands up. Open your inner man to Christ, the Lord, the one who loves you with redeeming love. And let him release in you today the healing that you need. Physically healing, emotional healing, even deep down things. Right now I release to you, in the name of Yeshua, our awesome Messiah, who came down from heaven to take on flesh and to minister in the earth and go to and die on the cross for us. As Glenn, who was here yesterday, ministered the Lord's table, he said, by his stripes, you were healed. And so today we pull down the strongholds in our own inner man that would resist trusting God totally for everything and receiving his full healing today. Physical healing. Emotional healing. Pulling down those strongholds of lies that many of us built up in us, where we have denied the truth and haven't been able to believe God. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I break those strongholds off you. In the name of Jesus, off myself, in the name of Jesus,
yes, Jesus.
That we can think freely,
yes, Jesus.
In the renewed mind, in the spirit of renewed mind, amen, that we can love unconditionally, no longer afraid, no longer hurt by the disappointments and the letdowns we've had in life. Thank you, Jesus. And I minister to you a deep repentance that leads to life, that leads to forgiveness and life, where you allow Jesus to, he says in Isaiah, you come and let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, though you might have some very serious issues that you're concerned about, Jesus, come and talk to me about it. Let's sit down together. Let us talk about this seriously now. You want to remain as you are, or will you allow me to wash you and cleanse you? So just tell Jesus what you want. Do you want Jesus to wash you and cleanse you today? Jesus, I want you to wash me and cleanse me today. Jesus, I'm asking you, Lord, to wash out of my subconscious old mindsets and trap snares, Lord, where my soul gets caught and I think things that are just stupid, that don't have any reality. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for the spirit of renewed mind.
Amen.
Thank you for the spirit of renewed mind.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Share the bread and the juice together soon. I just want to read a little bit from Isaiah. And it says, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of dry ground. He goes on, he is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid from him, we hid our faces from him. He was despised, we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, but he was wounded for our transgressions. And it goes on to verse 10, yet it says, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. And he shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. And by his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. And I was just in relation to that, I was just thinking this morning how in Numbers it talks about when the children of Israel had murmured and complained and against God, and he'd sent serpents amongst them, and as a punishment, and they were being bitten, many were being killed by these serpents. So Moses cried out to the Lord, and he said, and God answered and said to Moses to build a bronze serpent, put it on a pole, and to put it up, and that all those who would look at the serpent would be healed. And what they were doing was they were looking at the very thing that was causing their death. They were actually looking at the very thing that was killing them, yet it was healing them. And it says in the scriptures that he who knew no sin was made sin so that we might become the righteousness of God. And so today when we celebrate this, you know, we look at the cross. You know, we can look at Jesus and we can see his love there and whatever, but he was actually made sin. And when we look at the cross, we see Jesus being made sin, the very thing that separates us and kills us. He was made sin. And as the children of Israel looked at the serpent that was killing them, they were healed. And as we look at Jesus made sin, so we are healed, we're set free, we're delivered. And this is what we're going to celebrate and partake in a few minutes. And if some people could come and just slowly and quietly distribute the juice and the... That would be great. There's just one, a couple of other verses I wanted to read. And... oh, yeah. I'll just read a little bit from John 19:30. And it says this in John chapter 19, from verse 28. It says, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that all things were now accomplished. All things were now accomplished. He'd done it. And that the scriptures might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. And now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. It's finished. Everything that relates to our salvation, our restoration, our healing, our deliverance, the restoration of his creation, everything was finished. It was finished. And he wants us to remember this today. He wants us to remember that it is finished. And it's now up to us, by faith, to appropriate and to walk in everything that Christ won on the cross. And so this is a marvelous meal we'll be remembering. We remember his shed blood. We remember his broken body. It pleased the Father to bruise him. It pleased the Father to crush him because he knew what was going to be won by it. He knew the victory. He knew the outcome of that apparent defeat, of that apparent, that it looked like catastrophe, but the Father knew the outcome. And so it pleased him. It actually pleased him to bruise him. It says in, I looked up the word please, just in the English dictionary, and it said to give joy or satisfaction. And that's hard to understand, but it gave the Father joy. It gave him satisfaction to crush him, to crush his son. Because by doing that, he would bring forth many sons. And this is, again, we share what this meal is all about. It's a victory meal. It's a meal of triumph. And so today, just one more scripture I want to read from Isaiah 45. And then we'll eat and drink together. I'm sure it's the right chapter. So Isaiah by the Spirit, Isaiah 45 verse 22, Isaiah by the Spirit prophesied, he said, look to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth. And so today we can look to Jesus. We can look to Jesus in this meal. We can look to his shed blood. We can look to his broken body, because everything that pertains to our healing, wholeness, salvation was finished in that work of the cross. And so, and it was wonderful how Paul ministered healing and emotional healing and physical healing today. And even as we take this now and as we eat and drink it together, is there any there? That's okay. I'll grab one. Let's look to Jesus and be saved. And I don't know if everyone here is even saved, but you know what? The word says, look to him, look to me. Well, in other words, look to Jesus and be saved. And if you're not saved today, you can be saved simply by looking to Jesus. Amen. And you can even share in this meal with us. Amen. Amen. So let us remember Jesus. And let us eat and drink together and remember this amazing victory. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, David. Let's lift up prayer for our nation now. Let's pray for our federal government, and the parliament is resuming this week, tomorrow or Tuesday, I'm not sure which day. Hey? Tuesday. Okay, it's on Tuesday. Hallelujah. Who'd like to pray for the nation and for the political representatives and leaders? Why don't we all pray then?
Yeah,
no one wants to do it individually. Let's all do it together.
Amen, Father.
So pray for our nation. Pray for the elected government. Pray for all the so-called crossbench senators who are a big key to this next term of government. Pray for our nation to face up to its indebtedness and be willing to make some sacrifice to stop the nation going into $1 trillion debt. Our nation's in a desperate place financially. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you for that awesome song we're singing today that had to go about Jesus Christ is Lord of the nations. Jesus Christ is Lord of Australia. And the strongholds of Freemasonry that our capital city's built on, even architecturally. So Walter Burley Griffin was a practicing Freemason, purposely designed Canberra according to their pattern. But we just call that to naught, amen?
Amen.
There's a statue outside of the ACT's legislature, which is another Freemasonry thing called the God of Ethos. And even federal politicians have made mention of that. And even Tony Abbott did, part of his downfall. Because he mentioned that we should all do something about the spirit of ethos, and he just disgraced himself. So, Father, we speak over our capital city, the working of God, the lordship of Jesus Christ, and that men and women who are in governmental positions and in elected positions will come to fear you, Lord God Almighty. Lord, your word says to pray for their salvation, to pray for the revelation of Jesus Christ to come into their hearts and lives. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's lift up Alberto and Tony. There's been some positive small reports coming back and some photos coming up on Facebook. The one yesterday had Tony ministering the Lord's table. Looked tremendous. Tony looks very happy. He's obviously handling the situation really well. What was it?
This came about midnight our time last night. Alberto said, great night last night. We ministered in a place called that, Zonocatlan. And he said our hostile apostles, but he actually meant host apostles. He clarified later. I said, I'm glad they're not hostile. But our host apostle Umberto and Pastor Gloria, they're on the same spirit. I taught on Jesus the apostle. Bless you all. Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's all pray for Alberto and Tony as their mission opens up to them. It's going really well so far. We give thanks to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. After they arrived, a whole new itinerary opened up within Mexico for them. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Let's lift up Brother Rob, who's we think is back in the Cairns area this weekend and slowly coming down the coast. He'll be in Gladstone on Sunday the 11th, which is 2 weeks away. Then we should see him a day or two after that, I think, across here. Be here for the school. He has an Islander couple coming with him from Cairns. Let's lift Rob up to the Lord. Let's all pray for Rob and his ministry over the next 3 weeks as he travels down and joins us here in the third week. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you for Rob. Apostle Rob, Elaine works with... Elaine, is it? Leanne. Apostle Rob works virtually full-time among the Indigenous up north with an Indigenous brother called Kevin Seaguy. Yeah. So you'll get to meet them in a few weeks' time. Hopefully Kevin's coming down as well, but we're not sure about that. Oh, he's going to come to January, so he won't be meeting Kevin in the near future. But let's lift up Kevin as well, who's recovering from a stroke. But he's back in the ministry, and he's up at Bamaga, right on the tip of the Cape at this present time. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for Kevin Seaguy. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Okay, now we'll take up the offering.
Hallelujah.
And the tithes. There's already something in here.
It's a miracle.
There's already one envelope in there.
Hallelujah.
Okay. Who's going to help me with the offering today? Yes, thank you, brother. Ronnie and what's the other one? Jocelyn, come on. So your bag's already nearly full. So you'll have to do well to catch up with him. So let's give generously and cheerfully to the Lord for his work. Janet and I were blessed on behalf of RMA on our southern trip. We brought home many thousands of dollars that the brethren generously gave us. Just very amazing. So God is giving us a little encouragement and endorsement financially in recent times over the last 12, 18 months, beginning with a substantial bequest from the late brother David McKelvey.
His niece came in here on Friday.
His niece? Oh, yes. Jenny, is it?
Yeah, just for
okay, good. And then another brother's been working miracles in business and benefiting us. There's some big offerings. And then everybody else is just paying their tithes and giving into the ministry. And so we're very blessed. I think our end of year accounts for the last financial year will show that we had a $600,000 income. And that's a big record. Hallelujah. Yeah. And we spend it all, you'll be pleased to know. We don't save it for a rainy day. A lot gets sowed into missions, as you know. Well, yeah. Thank you. So we just thank the Lord. We're looking to grow and increase in numbers and grow and increase financially so that... Oh, Mama Adolphine, bro. So we wish to grow both in numbers and financially so we can support more people in ministry to be able to go out in full-time ministry. Hallelujah. We believe we're entering into a time of great fruitfulness.
Amen.
And so the nature of this next, the rest of this service is to just share the vision of sending out teams today to plant two new churches in Toowoomba. And this is a very exciting development. There'll be a substantial group of us staying here at Shiloh. So Shiloh will continue strongly under a fresh leadership of Debbie and Miriam, and we'll come to that shortly. I'm just going to ask Nick to come and just share what's been happening at his home place and how that's developed into really embracing what we're doing today.
Amen. So we moved into the place we're in now in Rockville, the village on the rock. It's all very prophetic. To get there, you go down Vanity Street. And so you've got to get over vanity and you've got to turn into make peace. And so then when you make peace with God, then you turn left into Priest Street. So you become a priest. But then you turn into trap, and you've got to get through the trap to find Featherstone Court, because we're living stones under the shadow of his wings, feathers. Hallelujah. So it's a very so it's a very prophetic address. And actually, you've got to head on North Street first to get onto Vanity. So you've got to start going up. Hallelujah. So, yes, we moved there a year ago, and it was totally in the will of God. And God was speaking to us at the time of us moving even. God spoke to me and my wife sort of separately. God spoke to me out of Numbers chapter 10, I think it is, where it says that the cloud that was leading the children of Israel in the wilderness settled down in a certain location. And God spoke to me and said, I'm leading you to a place where I will settle down with you. And so I knew that this was going to be a place where we would be for a time. And that word settled down is the Hebrew word shekan. Say shekan. And it's where they get the word Shekinah from, talking about the glory which has is abiding, settling down. And so I felt that God spoke that to us. And to Rhoda, he spoke about it being Rehoboth. Say Rehoboth. Rehoboth means to have room or space in the land. And so God showed us that we're going to a place where he's making room for us and for him to settle down with us. And there was even spiritual warfare to even get the place. We ended up it was awesome. We got the victory and God gave us that place. And ever since we were there, we've always wanted to reach out into that area. It's been classed as a lower type of socioeconomic area, just a lot of housing commission places in that area. And once we get to know some of the neighbors, they started telling us stories of years gone by, of fires in the middle of the road and druggies walking through everywhere and all this sort of stuff. And And we just got to start to tell them, well, we've been praying for this area, praying even in coming into this area. We never got a negative response. The first person we told that, we said, we're pastors and we've been praying into this area. We're excited about this area. She said, oh, the first lady that we told about that, she said, oh, that's great. You know, keep praying, please. And everyone we spoke to was always encouraging of us being in that area. And not long after we were there, we began a Sunday school for the children in the area. And so we went around the families and just told them that we were going to start up on Sunday afternoon, something for the children to come. They can learn about Jesus, learn about the Bible with us and have some fun with us as well. And again, everyone just about was quite happy with that. And so we ended up having sometimes up to 11 of the local kids from the area coming to our place on a Sunday afternoon. Now it's mainly, well, now that the Samuellas have moved in, that's another story. We always generally have about 8 children on that Sunday afternoon in our place. And we still have relationships with some of the older ones as well. And so from that, we'd always had it in our hearts that we would love to keep reaching out into this area, because we just feel a grace to be able to go to different families and invite them and talk to them. We had a Christmas outreach in December where we had a barbecue and a number of four households in our area, 4 separate households from us came to that Christmas time. And it was a great time. And we watched the Nativity movie as well. So some of the younger children really loved that, watching that. Had to tell them what circumcision was because, you know, in the Nativity movie, it's full on. I didn't realize that when we were watching it again, we thought, oh, dear. And so some of the kids are going, what's happening? I said, well, this is a very educational movie as well. So we've had some really good times with the people in our neighborhood. One particular lady as well, we've been bit by bit just able to start leading to Jesus. She's coming out of a New Age type of background. And she used to get very uptight and anxious, and she's actually growing. And she just recently, in talking to her, she was just saying, look, I know it's Jesus. Yeah, I know it's Jesus. Like, it's not anything else. I know it's Jesus. And I was able to give her a devotional book recently, and she took that really happily because I showed her how to use it, just a short little bit every day. And she thought, oh, that's great. Thank you. And she wanted to give me a big hug. So we're really, so there's people that we're just bit by bit reaching out to in that area. And in recent months, the Samuellas, maybe you want to put the camera on them. So this is the Fijian family over here.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So recently, Justin, you can all smile, Ted. So the Samuellas, which includes also Vero, who's up the back over there. So there's Vero, the papa of the family, Kinney, his wife and mother, and Maritha, who's Auntie Maritha, really. She's a dear sister in the Lord who lives with them as a family, and four children, Holly and Aroni, Ted and Jocelyn. They moved in there. In fact, the house they are living in was a housing commission place that the Department of Housing put up for sale. And a French man named Pascal from Maringendan bought it. And I got to meet him. And we had some good chats every now and again. And then the wife of Pascal was actually working at an employment agency with Kinney. And so they were talking, and Kinney was saying, we're looking for a place because they had to move out of their other place. And Pascal's wife said, I know a place for you. And so anyway, they took them to have a look at it. And as they were showing them, they were actually telling them, oh, and also what's really good here is, see that house over there? There's a lovely couple there. Huh? There's a teacher, he said. There's a teacher over there who on a they have a Sunday school where they teach the children, and it'd be great for your children. So he was even using us to help sell to rent the place to them. And then when they saw our place, they recognized, oh, that's Nick and Rhoda's place. So anyway, they've moved in just across the road from us. And while I was away in Malaysia and India, what started to develop was Rhoda inviting them over on a Wednesday morning for worship, prayer and the Lord's table and some reading of the scriptures to start happening in the house with us. And so ever since then, and it's continued since I got home, that every Wednesday, and it was Thursday for a little while, now it's back to Wednesday, we're meeting from 6:30 to 7:15-ish, around that sort of time, to have worship, prayer, and the Lord's table, and the reading of the scripture together. And we've been praying together. So what Paul was sharing in that teaching session about prayer and evangelism, that's been developing already, because we've been praying for the people in our street by name. We've been praying for the whole area. We pray for Toowoomba. We pray for Australia as well. We pray for lots of things, but we always pray for our area. And some of the developments that have been happening is, we in the park, there's lots of graffiti. And through the prayer, one of the strategies, I guess, that God got to give us to start to reach out and meet more people was he put it in our hearts to do a petition of our area, to petition the council to get rid of that graffiti, which is commissioned graffiti. Like, they're actually, it's, you know, it's purposefully there, but it's horrible stuff. And so we petitioned. So we went around our whole neighborhood and we met all these new people that we'd never met before. And in doing that, we've actually got more connections now. And there's another family who we've been able to connect with a little bit, who possibly will even come on a Friday morning when we have the mothers and toddlers group there, because she's got some young ones. And so, yeah, through that, and also the good thing out of that was the council actually received that petition and they're going to do something about the graffiti. Hallelujah. So even our prayers getting answered that way. Another thing that's been happening is our area has been used for a lot of drugs in the past, and still, even recent times, it's been used. There's houses in our area that have been used for drug dealing and drug taking. And so we've been making that a real matter of prayer. We didn't realize how close to home it was. In fact, right next door. But we've been praying for our area, that it become a drug-free area, that the people in that area either come to Jesus, repent from taking drugs, or they get removed and taken out of the area, and it become a great place for the kingdom of heaven. And as we've been praying for that, the police have been doing raids. And on one particular morning, we didn't even know. In fact, Rhoda and I were up with the children on this morning, and we were praying in our meeting room area and worshiping God together, but we had the curtains closed at that time. And right at that time that was happening, Debbie was actually getting Maritha for a driving lesson. And while Debbie's there, suddenly all these police rock up at the house next door to ours. In fact, 8 policemen, and Maritha comes out for the driving lesson, sees Debbie, but then looks past Debbie over the road next door to our place and sees all these police going into this house. And she goes, oh, and she ran back in to tell the family, God's answering our prayers. Hallelujah. So awesome things have been happening already. And now the next development is to establish a Sunday meeting there. So with the Samuelas' foundational part of that street even, and in that locality, we've been praying. And God has been starting to give us some strategies, more strategies to be reaching out besides the ones that have already been there, especially through the children. Amen. So we're very excited about what God is doing and about being launched and sent into that area, because we just have it in our hearts. It's given by God that this area can change with the gospel coming through us. And it is to do that. And we're hungry to win souls in that area, and to see the church begin to thrive in that area. People calling on the name of Jesus, people finding him in reality. Amen. Wonderful. Hallelujah.
So just stay here. So let's just thank the Lord for the tithes and offerings that have come in here today and have come in through the bank account and all the gifts and tithes we received on the southern trip. Father, we want to thank you today for everyone who's given into this ministry in recent times. Lord, it's just a big blessing to see the way the finance comes in. And we thank you firstly, Lord God Almighty, and we thank every person who has given something to support this ministry to continue to reach out in Australia and to over 50 or even 60 nations now. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Yes, please.
And one other thing that God led us to do, was it last weekend or the weekend before, I think? We, on a Sunday afternoon after being here, the Samuelas and Rhoda, myself and the boys, we went to the park that is just at the cul-de-sac of our street, because that park has been used for drugs and in the past, and it's the park that's got all that graffiti. And we're really believing, because when we went around the families petitioning, we realized there's a lot of families with children that we never see. And the reason we never see them is they say, we never use that park. You know, we just don't want to take our kids to that park. We always drive somewhere else. And so we realized that even though there's a park in our area, most of the families don't even use it because they're afraid of stepping on a needle or, you know, just of not good stuff being there. And so the Samuelas and our household, we both went there as two households into the park Sunday week ago. And we broke bread and we broke the power of the spirit of drugs and drug addiction and of just the wrong spirit, the unclean spirit that came into that area. And so in the Lord, we've claimed it back by taking the Lord's table there and proclaiming that Jesus has won the victory in that area and that this is a place for the kingdom of God where families can come. It's a place where the atmosphere is changing so that families can have a good environment for their children to bring them up in the park at our place. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Okay, so we need Rhoda and the boys and the Samuela family Donna, please. Has anyone else committed to go to be part of this church plant?
Yes, Donna.
Yes.
And the other ones now are...
Samuelas.
Yeah, the Samuelas come up here.
So we're sending out these folks. If too many more join, Nick will have to get a bigger house already, but... Amen. Wow. No, just... So, wow, look at this. We've already got PNG and Fiji and Australia represented in this house church.
Hallelujah.
Amen. So, some of you mightn't want to send them out, but we ask you to join us in sending them out because this is a step of to bear fruit and also to, it's an obedient step and it's also a step to for greater discipleship for every one of these men and women and young people because Nick and Rhoda run a fairly tight ship at their home. Their little boys are well discipled. Brother Arif was quite impressed. He don't think he'd ever seen children being trained properly like he saw Nick and Rhoda training their boys at home. And so, House Church, you need to be ready for discipleship. Nick and Rhoda want to teach you the pattern of how to live in Christ and to be fruitful in your lifestyle. Amen. Hallelujah. So, Janet, you want to come and join me Vincent and Ray, would you sacrificially come and send this team out? I reckon if you do it, then we'll all be in agreement. Because I don't think Ray wanted to lose Nick and Rhoda from the meetings here. Not do any of us, but we want to send them out. And so I'm going to ask Vincent and Ray to do that for us, because they came home to the bad news for them that Nick and Rhoda are going to be going out from Shiloh. But we want you to send them out today.
Father, we give you thanks for Nick and Rhoda and for everyone that's represented here. And Lord, we thank you for the light that is going into that area. And we thank you that the darkness cannot stand against the light. And we thank you for the faithfulness of everyone that's here. And Lord, we send them forth in your name into that area to bear fruit. In Jesus' name.
Father, I just thank you for your blessing in this big family, that they are all one together. Father, I thank you for all the children that will grow up loving each other and loving those in the neighborhood and being a good examples for others. Father, I just thank you that you love them and they love in turn for all that they reach from that house church. Amen.
Amen.
And so, Jesus, we do pray for this fellowship that you're planting in the earth, Lord, for the sons that you're raising up. But, Jesus, you just showed me that you're the Lord of the breakthrough. And so, Father, we just pray that your anointing to break through into that community would be released today, would be released to Nicholas in Jesus' name, released to you, to Rhoda, and to release to every person that is a part of this fellowship to break through and to bring forth fruit and to multiply in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Okay, so thank you. So, Aroni, what next Sunday you'll be meeting at Nick's house instead of coming here, okay? Aroni? Aye, good. So we also have asked, and today we want to appoint Judith and Elizabeth to go forth also to plant a Sunday house church. So please come out. And if you've already decided to be part of this house church, come and join them. It's going to be hosted in the home of Darlene, who's away this weekend in Sydney, awaiting the birth of a grandchild, is it? So Darlene's obviously committed, and little Kiona. And can you just share a little bit of how God's been speaking to you about this development?
Well, how it first began, I was thinking about it last night, and we received a word about multiplying and about sons being added and God calling them from the east and the west. And so we had that word that we received, and I thought, well, God, how would that happen? How would that come to pass? And I just suddenly saw that for that to be possible, we'd have to go into house church. And so it was something that was an idea planted by the Lord that, yeah, we would have to go into house church. And so from then we had a weekend where it was like an explosion, wasn't it? Yeah, where just God bringing forth that we are to break into house churches. And so that's something that is definitely now cemented in me. And I see that this is a perfect way then for everyone to start to be built up in the Lord. Amen. And to start to contribute in Jesus. Yep.
What would you like me to share? Have you got any word to share about what's happening?
I'm excited about house church. I mean, looking forward to, just had it in my heart to do house church really since the beginning of the year, especially seeing how much Jordan blossoms and is really blessed in that environment when you're in a smaller group, when we've been sent out to the house churches in Caboolture or Gladstone. And so, when it was then coming from Papa and Nick's heart that's in their heart to do house church, I was just ecstatic. I was like, yes, I want to be a part of this if possible, and to see that it's going to be a part of other families as well, like the Armitage family and Darlene's family, to really have that space where we can grow as where we are in the Lord, so every member of his body can be growing and we can be ministering to the youngest, to the eldest, and definitely praying into how God wants us to reach out is exciting too.
Yes, thank you. So, David Nels, would you like to come and send this group out to plant the church in the house? You may be aware that on Tuesday nights there are two home fellowships that have been happening. One's been happening for 12 months, over 12 months now, well over 12 months. It used to be held at the home of Fran and Stuart when they were on board with us. And sometimes toward about this time last year, we asked Miriam to take the leadership of that group as part of her training. And that group continued to grow and increase. So by the beginning of this year, we realised we had to have another house meeting. And so we just asked some of those people to meet over the other side of town with Judith. And so those Tuesday night meetings have been going really well, and both Judith and Miriam have really grown in ministry leadership just by having those house groups. And a number of folks here have been part of them, and even some folks who you don't see at Shiloh have been attending them sometimes as well. So that was like the foundation. But this is a new group now. Helen and Gay have been part of it, But the Armitage family have wanted to join because they really have a heart for house church. A lot of their background has been church in the house and been at Shiloh now for a while. And when Rick heard the news, he was really happy because he said, I was just starting to think it's a bit same old, coming into Shiloh every week. And suddenly he's got a big challenge in front of him now to be part of a church plant back in the house. Thank you, David.
Yeah. What's the name of the street? Okay. Well, Father, we are excited about this new initiative. Lord, we call upon your name. Father, we seek your blessing upon this. Lord, we pray for great wisdom for Elizabeth and Judith and others involved in the leadership. Lord, we ask that this house church would soon, Lord, it would grow. We pray for fruit. We pray, Lord, that it would grow so big that they would need to again split. Yeah. Father, we pray for much fruit. We pray for your guidance, your blessing. And, Lord, we ask that, that you would honor this move. Yes. And, Lord, there would be wonderful things happening. Lord, we pray for local people to be saved, to be drawn. We ask that this place would be a real beacon, a real lighthouse in that area. Father, and many people would know where to find Jesus. Yes, Father, we ask this in your name. Yes, amen.
Lord, we thank you for all the different ages in this group. Thank you for the men and women, the boys and girls. Lord, I pray you to knit them together to be one in you. And Lord, that would be clearly visible to the people around. Lord, we pray for a real blessing on Darlene's house. Lord, even through having this meeting, this group coming together in her home. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the new work you're beginning.
Amen.
Praise you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. We just want to give a fresh commissioning to Judith as the leader of the group. It's a big step for her, so Janet and Debbie come and help with that. It's a big step for Judith to step into a more responsible ministry role. And we thank God that Elizabeth has jumped in from the first to stand beside Judith. But Judith is the leader, and so we lay hands on you today, Judith, and commission you afresh now. In this work of ministry you're going into, in the name of Jesus the Messiah. Hallelujah. And we release through the laying on of hands, Judith, the grace and the release of the gifting, the release of wisdom to be the overseer and shepherd of this flock that God is entrusting to you now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And so the Lord himself is standing over you, Judith. If you look up, you'll see him. And he's authorizing you. Yes, hallelujah. So finally, the work of the ministry that God's called you to do is between you and him. Yes. And if you look up to him, you'll always have the confidence to go forward. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Did you? Yes.
Amen. Yeah, it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. So it's not you, it's nothing you can do, but it's by the power of the Spirit of God working in you and through you. And we thank you, Lord, that you have placed your spirit in Judith, and she can draw on that spirit, and she can walk in that spirit any constantly, day by day. Thank you, Jesus.
And I saw Jesus put his hand on your forehead and release oil to you. And he says, you are my choice. And he's sealed you for the work of ministry that he's given to you to do. Amen. So, Father, we just release that anointing now in the name of Jesus. An abundant anointing and abundant grace.
Amen.
Amen.
So we include Darlene and Kiana in all those prayers. God bless you, folks. So you can see that our community weekends are going to become more important as of today. It's like today's been the launching of it. There's been a tremendous freshness here today. But, you know, we mightn't see a lot of each other in between the community weekends. I mean, Charlotte's going to continue to operate as it has been, although at the same time, same time we've thrown everything up in the air at the moment, just waiting to see what comes down. So community Sundays will be well advertised, and also there'll be probably more regular community type events for the different house churches to come together, whether it's all the house churches or just some. But we want you to keep reaching out, always looking to be part of the bigger group, reaching further, and putting on gatherings that new ones can easily come into, not just a Sunday church meeting in the house church, but other activities in the house or in the park or wherever to draw people into. You know, months ago when the two house groups, no, it was just one house group, wasn't it? Judith, that day we did in the park? It was just your group, was it?
It was
the two. The two house groups of Miriam and Judith. We met in the house over at, in the park over at New Farm,
Newtown,
and it was just awesome. And, you know, Deborah's landlord, Noel, Rick Walker's stepdad, he was there. And it was just a great day of so many different people gathering together for a barbecue lunch in the park. So, I know I've just forgotten something. It'll come back. Yes, so at Kabbalah, there's two families stay there now, as you may well be aware. There's Mr. and Mrs. Macken and their firstborn, Anthony. And there's Mr. and Mrs. Pedden and their only born, Esther. Firstborn and only born. And the Peddens live in two caravans, but have been invited by the Mackens to share the facilities in the house. And so, Lex, you just come and give us a little update on what's happening out there in at the home base. How the two families are working together.
This is a new thing for both of us. These words came out of my mouth one day when Tim was saying, you know, we're going to sell the house and get some caravans. And these words were, why don't you come and live with us? I thought, who said that? But then I went home and I said to Terry and Anthony what I'd done, and they were agreeable as well. And, you know, so the Pedens, I mean, we had a plan and it was going to be, you know, plan A, but God had a different plan for us all. And as the weather has gotten colder, the Pedens come inside the house more frequently to enjoy the fire. But, you know, we share meals together. Sometimes the Pedens cook their meal and we cook ours, and they just come into the house and we have it together. Sometimes we have it separately. They help with chores around the house as well. There's no dissension anywhere. It is just something really awesome and something that was designed by God, I believe, in his heart. And every morning we have devotions together. So 7 o'clock or thereabouts, we go through the Bible plan together.
Is Esther been attending?
You
can answer that later.
So we read through the Bible together, we have communion together, and then we pray together. And it just, you know, it's, to me, it is the Acts Church in action, you know, and it's not something that we planned. It just sort of came out of God's heart, I believe. And I'm excited about what we're doing out there, but also we are going to be more purposeful about inviting various groups out to our house, because God has given us an awesome house and a wonderful property. We wake up in every day and say, another day in paradise, even when it's freezing and, you know, full of frost, another day in paradise. Yeah, so expect some invitations from the Kabbalah House Church.
Amen. Thank you. Awesome. So in consultation with Pastor Aaron and the Kabbalah House Church, they have decided that my invitation to stop having Sunday meetings for a season and attend here at Shiloh on Sundays. And And for Aaron, Aaron's going to be doing a little bit of work among a local church at Meringandan for a season. Hopefully, is that still opening up, Aaron? Oh, it's not opening up. Well, that's very interesting, isn't it? Yeah. But I think the Wednesday night discipleship, prayer and discipleship is going to continue at Kabbalah. Yep. So they're going to continue a Wednesday night meeting, but Sundays are going to be free and available. So just the thing about the house church I want to mention is that they're not open meetings, because it's actually illegal to have church in the house in that sense. You can't advertise a meeting in your house. The authorities will probably eventually come down on you and say you're not allowed to do that. You have to be in a set place of worship. So the house churches won't be advertising. It's by invitation only, okay? So you just can't, I'm not asking any of you just to rock up at any of the house churches, because frankly, you're not welcome. Because it's by invitation only, okay? So if you would like to attend one of the house churches, see the leader and ask if you could be included to come along. Because the reason in sending out the house, even though Nick's is already too big, it seems, but it's to be evangelistic, to reach new ones, as well as disciple the group that's going with the plant. So it's twofold. It's to plant the church and expect it to grow. But then in doing that, it's discipling the ones that you have. And we haven't talked it all fully through, but some of the discipleship classes will now be happening from now on within house churches. It's already started out at Meringandan. Aaron's been teaching purposefully on Wednesday nights out of one of the manuals, and I'll be encouraging that to happen in all the house churches, the two new ones here in Toowoomba, that you disciple the people within your house church, that you become less reliant upon Shiloh. Amen? You know, I said to the leaders a while back, you know, can we imagine life without Shiloh? Well, if we move in the houses and the house church pastors and leaders take up the responsibility of discipleship, we can. We can start to imagine life without having a wonderful building like this. Not that we're expecting to lose the building, but we need to live as if we are. Amen? Because nothing in that sense is permanent. So, but Shiloh is going to continue apace. And with that group of people moving out, I think there's about, it was close to 30 out here altogether, counting Darlene and her daughter, I think. But that leaves about the same number still here, about 30 probably, I don't know. And so for the group here, we've asked Debbie to be the pastoral leader. And we've asked Miriam to be her assistant. At the present time, Miriam is the leader of the Tuesday night house ministry, which a number of you are involved in. And she'll continue in that leadership and in that ministry. And Debbie does support her there. But here in Shiloh today, we're actually going to ordain Debbie as a pastor. She's never been officially ordained. And today we're going to officially ordain her to be Pastor Debbie. And she will be giving the leadership with Miriam's help in keeping the Shiloh, not just the Shiloh meetings going, but providing the pastoral care and oversight of the Shiloh church. Janet and I will be based here at Shiloh. And so whenever we're home, I mean, occasionally we might go to one of the other meetings if we're asked to, but our primary responsibility will be here as part of the Shiloh Fellowship meeting here. As we said, during the week, things will continue as normal, except that won't be normal. We hope it'll be super normal. And, and because we really are wanting to revamp everything to become more focused on outreach, reaching out, sending out. Amen? So I'd like to call upon Debbie to come forward. And I've asked Jean to come and help me, and Janet. We want to ordain Debbie, and maybe Aaron and David Nelson would come as well. So Debbie was commissioned as a pastor quite some years ago and served as a pastor out in the Meringandan House Church for some years. So she learnt the ropes there, taught by Rob, and so even though I know she's a little bit scared, she's quite confident, I think.
Amen. Gosh, what God can do. You know, take a broken vessel and have his way in someone who's willing to yield and to give up their own ideas on life and just allow him to work through them. You know, some of you know me, when I first came here, I was not like this. Yes, it was scary. But, you know, God has been at work in me. And so today is kind of an overwhelming day for me. I'm very honored and I feel very humbled to be asked to be your pastor. I know that I have nothing in me but only Christ, and it's him who will do that ministry. It will be the ministry of Christ coming forth. I'm very committed. I'm very excited. I'm a little fear and trembling, but I know that it's God. I have this knowing within me that this is God. You know, before the girls, I actually wasn't at the prayer meeting that they brought up the subject of, you know, starting new house plants. But for a few weeks before then, I'd be saying to God, I really miss house church. I really miss the way it functions and it's vibrant. I just miss that. You know, so when the girls came and brought that report home to me, first of all, I was shocked. And then they were explaining to me what my role would be, and then I was extra shocked. But then, you know, during the night, just praying, talking to the Lord, great peace came to me. And it's like the Lord is saying to me, Debbie, this is the way, walk in it. And then a couple of weeks ago when I was preaching, I was sharing on the 10 virgins. There was just this moment. This was before I knew any of this was happening. There was this moment that while I was in the middle of preaching, it was like I was outside of myself, watching myself, speaking the word. But then I looked at all of the people and they were all sheep. And God broke my heart for the sheep. And he put this love for me, in me, for his sheep. So even then I thought, God, that was weird. What did you do that for? They all like had little sheep faces and it was weird. And for days after, I'm like, what was that? You know, but just this great compassion in my heart for his people. And so then when everything started changing and I went, oh, I see, you're giving me that heart for your people. And so I take it very seriously and I am very honored that the Lord would choose me to do this. So I'm very excited about everything that's happening and it's wonderful days. And I'm really looking forward to involving more and more people. So, you know, be ready to run. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Debbie.
Thank you, Jesus. So, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Debbie, we anoint you with oil and we set you in place as an ordained pastor today in the body of Christ, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Jesus, for the power and authority you give to us in Christ to ordain this woman to the ministry today, to ordain Debbie Van Lathan to the ministry of pastor today in the body of Christ, serving firstly here at Shiloh Christian Fellowship. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I anoint you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for this great work. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
So, Debbie, there are a few mentions in the New Testament about the Good Shepherd, and Jesus himself is the Good Shepherd. And John chapter 10 tells what the role of the Good Shepherd is, to lead the flock and the flock to hear his voice. But Jesus gave this commission to Peter. Just before he ascended into heaven, Jesus said to Peter, "Feed my sheep, tend my sheep." Yep. It's a twofold commission. It's a commission of teaching and feeding, nurturing, looking after. And he actually called them lambs on one occasion. In other words, there are the babies to nurture as well as the sheep to feed. And then Peter, in his latter years, wrote this beautiful epistle saying, "The elders who are among you, I exhort, I who am a fellow elder." In other words, he was recognizing the shepherding role that he was given by Jesus Christ, and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. The commission he gave to these people was, "Shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly, nor as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away." And so I believe the Lord wants to release that to you today, to oversee the flock that is among you, to tend the sheep, to nurture the lambs, to feed the sheep, and serve as an overseer, not by compulsion, but with that love that Christ has put in you, Debbie. Amen.
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 Thank you, folks. Miriam, would you like to come? Just stay here. So this is Debbie's assistant. Would you receive Miriam? Amen. Yesterday we heard Miriam bring the Word of God as a teaching yesterday afternoon. If you weren't here, it was very marvellous. Miriam's been sharing publicly for some years now, but yesterday was just very different. She stepped into a greater authority in the Word and ministered very, very powerfully. So we are really encouraged, and that Miriam is a good fruit of the discipleship and training here. So now she's taking another step in ministry to serve as an assistant pastor. And so I want to commission her. She's already a commissioned minister, but today I want to speak over to her that pastoral role. Amen? Is that okay? Yep.
Janet, just come and help me. So Miriam, we're giving you a fresh commissioning today.
Thank you, Jesus.
To the role of pastor. You're going to be an assistant pastor here as such, but there'll be times when you'll be it, because Debbie won't always be here. So I anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I speak over you the ministry of the pastor and commission you to do that ministry now. To shepherd the flock of God, giving oversight in as the Holy Spirit enables you. Amen. And Miriam, we thank you for the testimony of your life in the Lord. We honour you today as a holy woman of God. And we thank Jesus for you. And we thank Jesus for the future he has for you as a minister. Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Yes, so for the rest of us Shilohites, plus the Meringandan folk, Kabbalah folk now, of course, who are going to be joining us, and I think it's going to be very important that the Kabbalah House Church joins us for a season here to strengthen the Sunday meetings, as we've sent out such a big group today, and so there'll be much for all of us to do, amen? So I've all told Debbie to be free to call on any one of you, young and old, to help in the work of the ministry here. So it's a new day.
Amen.
It's a very exciting day.
Hallelujah.
And I think I've covered all the notes I had. Is there anything Yes, that's right. We're going to send Siobhan out. Where's Siobhan? She's coming up. Talking about sending, she's going on an overseas trip to England. Is that right? Yes, let's do that. Why don't Elizabeth sis, you come and send your sis out. Tell the folks what you're doing.
Well, praise the Lord. I'm heading off to the UK for hopefully a couple of years, however long the Lord sends me for. I've been in my current career. I'm a checkout operator at a Coles supermarket 4.5 years. It was time to step out of my comfort zone, you know, like God was pushing me to not just exist, but to actually live, like to really go out, gain life experience and just, yeah, I'm just praying that I'll stay in God's will. I'm over in the UK and, yeah, I don't know what else to say. Like
going on just, a big exploration
exactly,
for your own life.
Yep. Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Come and send her out, girls.
Yes, Father, we thank you for Siobhan and we do lift her before you. And Father, we want to send her as she goes and prepares to go to England. Lord, we send her in your name. Lord, we ask that you would prepare the way before her. Lord, that she would walk in those good works that you have ordained for her. And Lord, we just bless her, yeah, and send her in your grace and with your presence, Father. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, Father, we just see those open pathways that you have before Siobhan's trip, and we just thank you that you will just continue to open doors for her, that you would connect her with those that you want her to meet with, and Father, that you would just be her provision all the way from now, Jesus, until she returns home to us. Thank you for providing and for giving her grace and for just opening those pathways for her life to blossom and to grow in you. Thank you, Jesus.
Are you meeting next Sunday or not?
No, it's the 11th of September.
Which day?
The 11th.
Okay. So the house church meeting on Sunday for Judith's group is not beginning until the 11th because Judith has a prior commitment, so she can't be available to start the house church meetings next Sunday, and we don't want them to start without her. After a few weeks, she's going to be away for about 5 weeks in a row. So Elizabeth will have plenty to do. But the folks who are going to be in Judith's house church be here on Sunday. And the folks who are in Nick and Rhoda's, you turn up at their house whatever time they've told you, okay? Just in terms of it, so that's the first announcement to know where you're going next Sunday. And we're having guests in our home on Wednesday and Thursday night, a leadership couple from Bendigo. They're coming up for a family wedding, and we've managed to get them to stay with us for a couple of nights, and they'll be in the Thursday ministry school here on Thursday morning. They're a couple a bit older than me, decades of service to the Lord in the Bendigo area, for a long time in Christian education. He was a principal. What wonderful couple. Very close to Todd Hunter, whom you've heard us speak of. And so they're coming up and they told me they'll report back to Todd. Todd's actually in Uganda at the moment. So this is a wonderful thing that's taking place because we've been wanting to have some influence in Bendigo and be part of the development of the church there. So it's just a godsend that this couple are able to be in Toowoomba and come and stay at our house for a couple of days and come to Shiloh to meet us if we're going to be here on Thursday and to see how we function here a little bit more intimately. Then on the Monday the 19th, we have a training school beginning, two weeks of the more formal teaching format, followed by a week of more informal discipleship class type of format. And a very special sister from Canberra is coming for the first week called Hilary Moroney, the person who runs the Canberra House of Prayer and the person who organised the Bible reading marathons earlier this year that Rob and Kevin and Arthur and Victor went down to do the night shifts for her. She's coming up for 1 week. We'll be staying in our house as well. Pastor Ashok from North India, Chandigarh, is coming for 3 weeks at least, and he'll be in the school. And we're still waiting to hear whether a brother from Myanmar will get through or not. Margaret Hooper's working on that for us. And Diane's coming down, as far as we know. Jenny Holliak's coming up. Susan is coming from Gladstone, plus another Susie from her congregation is coming for at least 1 week. Who else is coming? Natasha's? Yes, and Bronwyn from Victoria is coming up for 2 weeks. They're Rob's friends, Andrew and Paula from Cairns, Ireland, a couple from Cairns. They'll be joining the Gypsy community out at Kabbalah. Yes, I think we've run out of time, love. Yep, so God bless you. We had a very good trip, and we visited 9 places. 2 of them were new contacts for Janet and I, and it was just wonderful everywhere we went. The brethren were great. It was easy to share the word from house to house and in the church at Rochester. It was just awesome. So God bless you. It's been an awesome day. It's been a historic day. Australia is giving us this nation and many nations. By his grace, we will fulfill his commission to reach every nation with the word of God, amen, beginning right here in Toowoomba and the surrounds, and reaching out into this nation. It is a new day. Just want to bless Don and Miriam Truss with us today. Don was just saying he's experienced the grace of God in a fresh way. Come and tell us quickly, Don. Yes. Don's a full-time school chaplain, serves in 3 schools still down in the valley.
Just give us a bit of an update on what you feel.
Okay. Well, I'd just say the last, I don't know, look, I've had a great season even this year in the schools, but I'd say the last 3 or 4 weeks just been a real noticeable just freshness for me, you know, even in my walk with God, but also in the outworking of what happens at the school. We've had a death of a parent. We've had, a family separation. I was thinking there's been quite a lot of traumas within the schools, but yet there's been an incredible grace just in my life to be able to minister in these situations. And I've had even a parent that came up to me the other day, just out of the blue, and we were just chatting and talking about their little son who has, I guess, high anxiety and things like that. And so I was playing handball with him while talking with her, saying farewell to lots of the children. And this parent, at the end of this conversation, she just said to me, she said, what you do here is incredible. She said, I've just watched you for the last 20 minutes. And she said, these children will never forget, you know, what you're doing in their lives. And she said, it is so noticeable what you bring to this school. And it was just a real blessing because, you know, sometimes you just, you know, you do the normal thing and you forget, I guess, the life of Jesus and the life that he's given us that just kind of comes out. And it needs to be just a real life that just flows. And so it's just a wonderful blessing to find that. And I've just had open doors. I've got a young, you know, a couple of young guys who are teenagers. A mother came to me and they've got teenagers who are really struggling, like, you know, even getting exposed to drugs at about the age of 13. And so she's desperate for help. And I just, you know, it's been on my heart for a little while to do something, but I didn't quite know what. And then, it was last Friday. I said to her, look, I'll make, you know, every second Saturday for a few hours in the morning available, and we'll just do something, whether it's woodwork, we'll build. Anyway, so he came down. He didn't want to come down initially, particularly this young guy. Once he got to I said, look, don't worry. So just bring him down. And, you know, once he's there, he can at least see, you know, see what's happening. And there's a lot of, you know, family friction. And anyway, he stayed and had a wonderful time. And I just see, again, as an opportunity just to engage with they're not a Christian family, but yet they need so much help. And so I just, you know, believing for wisdom, just to slowly sow into these guys' lives. And I've got another young guy, he's a Christian young fellow who I've been working with for the last few years, and he's now coming as well. So he's going to help out, and hopefully we'll just see what doors open up with these families. So there's a lot of really needy families, and it just seems really fresh. Like, there's just open doors to connect. And, you know, mum and dad, mum's going around to visit a mother on Monday, and that opened up again because she just rang the school in desperate state, wanting to walk away from 4 kids. And so I spent long time on the phone with her, and she's just willing to receive whatever help. And I just said, you know, look, you know, we've got some wonderful church community people who'd, you know, love to come and help you. And she was waiting 4 weeks for counselling or some support from an agency. She was told it was 4 weeks before they could come out. And she said, I can't wait that long. And so, you know, just being available and being ready to do what God opens up is it's wonderful. So.
So we haven't got time to allow them to testify, but Steve's just got a new job. Congratulations, Steve. Joshua's got a new job. Congratulations. And Elizabeth's got a job. Congratulations. Elizabeth's been appointed as the pastor of a church of 80 young women. Isn't that awesome? And she's getting paid 15 hours a week for the privilege. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Brother Tim, just quickly, how's your work going?
God is transforming people's lives and bringing families into the kingdom of God.
Yeah. So Tim's a homeschooling teacher who goes into homes to help the families disciple their students. Is that right? Does that summarize it?
I do Bible studies, I pray with him, I'm
just yeah.
You do some school work as well?
35 families?
I've got nearly 60 kids.
60 kids in 35 families. Isn't that awesome? See, there's something happening, folks. God's raising the alternatives that he needs to have in place for the remnant church to survive in glory in the last days. As the persecutions and sufferings increase all around us. Amen.
Amen.
You know it's going to be illegal to be a Christian soon, don't you? It's going to be just like at the beginning of the church age. We'll be forced to bow the knee to government or pay the penalty. So get ready for it. Amen? And God's raising just things like Tim's homeschooling job. You're just movies like God's Not Dead coming out. There's so many little voices just raising here, there. Muslims getting dramatically saved. Amen. Even England coming out of the common market. That's just God slowing things down a bit to get the church ready. So that when globalization does take over, there'll be a church that will stand and will not bow the knee. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. So lots of things happening. Stay awake. Stay alert. Don't be myopic. You know what that means, Tim? Esther, what's myopic mean?
I don't know.
Myopic is having a very close vision. Amen. Lexi, you're going to prophesy.
Maybe bless the lunch.
Eh? Bless the lunch. What? Deborah, bless the lunch for us.
Can I share something first? I did a thing on a canvas, Aaron's rod. I don't know whether some of you have seen it. It's the rod of Aaron, which blossomed, fruited and budded all overnight because of the anointing of the Lord. And yesterday I finished embroidering it and made it three-dimensional, and I want to give it to Paul, but I didn't bring it in. But it's three-dimensional here today. If you can see that this whole ministry, when we've stepped out of our natural bodies and seen what Jesus wants to do in this place, he's promised to bud, to blossom and to fruit this ministry in Jesus' name. And so, Father, we just want to thank you for the food provided for us downstairs. We ask you to bless it to our bodies and us to your service in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Deborah. Lunch downstairs.